सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। ॐ सदाशिवसमारम्भां शंकराचार्यमध्यमां अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वंदे गुरुपरंपरां श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानां आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादं शंकरं लोकशंकरं समस्तजनकल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्म विद्वरम्। I will chant first 12 verses. भज गोविंदम भज गोविंदम गोविंदम भज मूढ़मते संप्राप्ते सन्निहिते काले नहि नहि रक्षति डुक्रिन करणे मूढ़जहि धनागम तृष्णां कुरु सद्बुद्धिं मनसि वितृष्णां यल्लभसे निज कर्मोपात्तं वित्तं तेन विनोदय चित्तं। भज गोविंदं भज गोविंदं गोविंदं भज मूढ़मते नारीस्तनभरनाभिदेशं दृष्ट्वा मागामोहावेशं एतन्मां सवसादिविकारं मनसि विचिन्तय वारं वारं। भज गोविंदं भज गोविंदं गोविंदं भज मूढ़मते नलिनी दलगत जलमति तरलं तद्वज्जीवितमतिशय चपलं विद्धि व्याध्यभिमानग्रस्तं च समस्तं। भज गोविंदं भज गोविंदं गोविंदं भज मूढ़मते यावद्वित्तोपार्जनसक्तः तावन्निज परिवारो रक्तः पश्चाज्जीवति जर्जर देहे वार्तां कोऽपि न पृच्छति गेहे। भज गोविंदं भज गोविंदं गोविंदं भज मूढ़मते यावत् पवनो निवसति देहे तावत् पृच्छति कुशलं गेहे गतवति वायौ देहापाये तस्मिन् काये। भज गोविंदं भज गोविंदं गोविंदं भज मूढ़मते बालस्तावत् क्रीडासक्तः तरुणस्तावत् तरुणीसक्तः वृद्धस्तावत् चिन्तासक्तः परमे ब्रह्मणि कोऽपि न सक्तः। भज गोविंदं भज गोविंदं गोविंदं भज मूढ़मते काते कांता कस्ते पुत्रः
संसारो यमतीव विचित्रः
कस्य त्वं कः कुत आयातः तत्त्वं चिन्तय तदिह भ्रातः भज गोविन्दं भज गोविन्दं गोविन्दं भज मूढमते सत्संगत्वे निसंगत्वं निसंगत्वे निर्मोहत्वं निर्मोहत्वे निश्चलतत्वं निश्चलतत्वे जीवन्मुक्तिः भज गोविन्दं भज गोविन्दं वयसि गते कः कामविकारः शुष्के नीरे कः कासारः क्षीणे वित्ते कः परिवारः ज्ञाते तत्त्वे कः संसारः भज गोविन्दं भज गोविन्दं गोविन्दं भज मूढमते मा कुरु धनजन यौवनगर्वं हरति निमेषात् कालः सर्वं मायामयमिदमखिलं बुद्ध्वा ब्रह्मपदं त्वं प्रविश विदित्वा भज गोविन्दं भज गोविन्दं गोविन्दं भज मूढमते
So the 10th verse we saw that when we remove the cause, the effect automatically disappears. So three examples were given. When the age is gone, there is no passion. When the water dries up, there is no lake. When the money is lost, there are no relatives. So ultimately to indicate to us that when the truth is known, then there is no samsara. So in that context, we also saw that samsara is what we create. Our own likes, dislikes, prejudice, attachments, all these are our creations. Jagat is the world created by the Lord. So we live in the same world created by the Lord, but each one lives in one's own samsara because we create our own shell, we are trapped in our own cocoon. So this samsara is that which is constantly changing. And how to know that which is changeless? Jnate tatve. When we know that which is the changeless truth, then the samsara disappears. Meaning the sorrow of the samsara goes away when we know that which is changeless. So now what is that which is preventing us? One of the things Shankaracharya ji says in 11th verse is dhana jana yauvana garvam. Pride of these is what holds us back. The sense of finitude, the sense of ego is strengthened by this pride. So if we have to overcome ego, first the effect of that ego, which is the pride and which sustains or strengthens this ego, that we should drop. So he says, Ma kuru dhana jana yauvana garvam. Do not have pride of dhana, wealth, jana, people, including lineage, progeny, friends, relatives, contacts, power, position, all these. And yauvana is one's own beauty. So yauvana is for the body, dhana is all the possessions that we have, jana is all our emotional attachments. So he says, give up all these. Why should I give it up? Because harati nimesha, not give up all these, give up the pride of all these, garvam. It is not said drop youth, drop people, drop the money. He said the pride that comes with it. we derive our self-worth from this. That I am successful if I have this much bank balance. I am a great man when I have these contacts. I look very handsome, so I am something in this world. So that pride that comes with these binds a person to this limited individuality. So he says, drop that pride. One main reason he gives is, harati nimeshat kala sarvam. In a moment, time can snatch this away. So kala here can also, has two meanings. Kala here means, one is time, that in time this will go away. And kala here also means death. At the moment of death, anyway, all this will be taken away. So we have no control over it actually. Even if we want to stop them, can't control. Each of them, dhana, jana, yavana, none of them one has control. To a certain extent, one can put one's efforts to get, but when it goes, nobody can stop. Yavana is going. For many it is gone, but they still believe it is not gone. They want to prolong it as much as possible. It is gone actually. Same way with money. Suddenly the rupee falls, suddenly it goes up. How does one know? It goes, when it has to go, it just goes. So, ma kuru dhana jana yavana garvam. People, the best of the people with whom one trusted, suddenly turns around. So harati nimeshat kala sarvam. Then he says, maya mayamidam akhilam buddhva. Know this entire realm as maya. It is changing. And if we want to know that which is permanent happiness, brahma padam tvam pravesha. You enter that state of Brahman, viditva, having known, having gained this knowledge. So now we will go a little deeper into this. These words which have come now, new words, Brahma, Maya, and a lot of people have a lot of notions about these. So in Vedanta it is important to have the clarity of these words, because then we know what it means. That's the reason, one of the reasons why we had the debate was that the state of, what is God, when we had to speak about, so many notions about God one will have. Those need to go. So Brahman, when we say Brahma, literally the word Brahma means the biggest. Brihatvat Brahma, that which is the biggest. There is nothing greater than that. So what can be the biggest?
Infinity.
Infinity is the biggest. In our culture, infinity also is described in three ways. If something satisfies these three criteria, then only it is called actually infinite. That which is beyond space, not limited by space, that means, not limited by time, not limited by object, then it is called infinite. Not limited by space meaning, it is everywhere. Not limited by time, it doesn't change. It remains constant in past, present and future. And not limited by object, meaning any number of objects cannot limit that. Like the mic limits the pen, pen limits the iPad, iPad limits the book. Each has its own features. But there is something which is common in all these, which doesn't limit, which is existence. So that which is infinite, infinity means that which is not limited by time, space and object. The beauty is this infinity is not to be known as a concept. He says, Brahma Padam Tvam Pravesha Viditva. Viditva. Know this infinity as you. that infinity is my nature. And having known this infinity as my nature, be free from Maya. We'll come more towards it. So the first word is Brahma. Brahman means that which is the biggest, number one. Brahman means that which is infinite. And infinite means that which is not limited by time, space, objects. Now this infinite truth, which we call as Brahman, is changeless, because not limited by time, space and object, meaning that which is changeless. So that which is infinite is changeless. Now from that changeless, can this world come which is changing? Logically, that which is changeless, can it produce anything? Can it create the world? Can any... Why it cannot produce anything? It is infinite, na? Infinite has no limitation, so infinite should be able to produce. Why infinite can't produce? There is no cause and effect, it is there, it cannot... Any production, meaning it was not there before, now it comes into existence. So the form was not there, it comes into existence. So the form is created, qualities are created, attributes are created. So that which is infinite does not produce anything. And yet we are seeing this world which is there. So from where did this world come? That is samsara. Perception and projection is in each individual's mind, which is what we call samsara. But the world, how did it come? Hills and the mountains and the rivers and the sky and the stars and all these, that is not our perception only. It is there and we are perceiving it. At this level of Vedanta, we have to understand that we are seeing it as Jagat, as separate from me. Then when I see it as separate from me, I have my own perception. So each one has their own perception.
So it is the Brahman, but we are not seeing it as that.
See, theoretically we are saying, agreed, that it is Brahman only, but we are not seeing it as Brahman. But how did Brahman produce the world? How did Brahman become this? Because that which is infinite does not produce anything. And yet there is a world. Can we say that there is some other cause other than Brahman which produced it? How Prakriti? Understandable. That is what Vedanta is saying. But before we come to that point, let us explore, if Brahman cannot produce the world, can there be some other cause for this world?
No.
Why it can't be? No, if you go to that fundamental level of inquiry, first you have to ask, do you exist? Forget mountains. Do I exist? Who is this I? That inquiry, when we start doing, then it leads to something else only. That is agreed. Here right now we go step by step, saying that, okay, the world is seen. Now from where did this come? Brahman cannot produce because Brahman is infinite. Infinite doesn't change. Infinite can't produce. So can there be some other cause of this Brahman, of this world? Cannot be, because that which is infinite covers everything. There is nothing outside that infinite, which is another cause which can produce. So now we are in a logical fix. There cannot be other cause than Brahman. And Brahman cannot produce. But still the effect is seen. World is there. How did that happen? Magic. So we say that this Brahman, using its own power of Maya, should not be okay. I will write it this side. So we say Brahman, using its own power of Maya, assumes a position of Ishvara. This Brahman, remember, is not Brahmaji with four heads. This is infinite Brahman, absolute truth. In that infinite, there is a power called Maya. This Maya is a creative power of Brahman. Just like you and I have different powers, power to sing, power to talk, power to write, power to compose a poetry, different powers. So in that which is infinite, there are thousands of things which will be there. The power of that infinite, one of the powers, is called as Maya. This Maya, using the power of Maya, Brahman assumes the role of Ishvara. Just like when we use the power of singing, then we become singer. Writing, we become writers. So we use this power. So using the power of Maya, Brahman becomes Ishvara, the creator. And that creator creates this universe. So this creator is depicted in our culture as the Trinity, Brahma, Vishnu and Mahesh. So the creation, sustenance and destruction, all these are actually one. While there is creation, there is sustenance also and destruction also. And in the every destruction, there is a new creation that keeps happening. They all are one actually. So the idea here is that this Maya is that power of Brahman. So the concept of Maya is brought in to give us a certain explanation that how the changeless appears as the changing. Changeless doesn't become changing, please remember. Maya only means an appearance. Using the power of Maya, this Brahman becomes an Ishvara and manifests as this whole world. So it's an appearance. The creation is an appearance. It is not a production. It is not a modification. It is an appearance. Like how the waker appears as the dreamer and the dream world and the dream character. The waker has not actually modified to become that. Thank God that has not happened. Otherwise, what will be our condition? Just imagine. You sleep as a man, get up as an elephant, anything can happen. Because you become like that. So the idea is that this is an appearance. And this concept of Maya is brought in so that we understand this whole concept of from where the creation came and understand that concept of the changeless truth. This is the beauty of Vedanta here, because Vedanta tells us that there is a changeless truth. Not everywhere we will find this concept. Maximum one will say that there is one God who created this world, and that God will be a personal God. And then everybody will start thinking about it, okay, there is one God, and if you pray to that God will fulfill all your desires, will remove all the troubles. But how can a personal God create this world which is infinite? One personal God cannot create. That is a personification done so that the mind can relate. Otherwise it is not possible for the mind to relate to that which is infinite. So this concept of Maya is brought in, and Brahman, using the power of Maya, assumes the role of a Ishvara, the creator. There's a very famous story for this, that once there was a merchant, very wealthy merchant in the Middle East, in the deserts, and this merchant had three sons. So when this merchant was about to die, he said that all my property must be divided in the ratio of 1/9 1/9, 1/3 and half. I think so. So 1/9, 1/3 and half. Right? So now all this wealth of this merchant, the money that he had, the various oil mills that he had and so many things he had, all that is divided into this division of 1/9, 1/3 and 1/2. But he had only 17 camels. And now these 17 camels have to be divided in this ratio. So how to divide the 17 camels in this ratio? Because they will die. You should not kill any camel. Without killing the camel, you have to divide in this ratio. Create a Maya Jal. So if you add one more camel, then what happens? 18 camels. So 18 divided by 9?
2.
You get 2. 18 divided by 3?
6.
6. 18 divided by 2? This is how much?
7.
Okay, division. And that one camel goes away. So no camel got killed also. Same thing, the concept of Maya is brought in, and by the time, so you use this Maya and go from Jiva to Brahman, and Maya disappears on its own. So this Maya is a very interesting concept, and it's not just a concept, because many people think ye to sirf concept hai. No, you are seeing the effect of Maya everywhere. What are the features of Maya? Let us see. This Maya is first and foremost, it is the power of Brahman, which depends on Brahman. Maya cannot exist on its own. In Tattva Bodh, we will see when we take it up later. Brahma Shraya, it is said. Just like a power of singing depends on the singer, the person. Same way Maya also is a concept, depends on Brahman. Is a power dependent on Brahman. It is not independent. What is the nature of this Maya? Three gunas. Sattva, Rajas and Tamas. How do we say that the Maya has these three gunas? From the effect we can infer the cause. If I see a mud pot, I can infer that the mud is the cause of this mud pot. So from the effect I can infer the cause, because the cause itself in another form is the effect. So in the world, when we look at the whole world, we find these three principles are functioning. First is the principle of inertia, tamas. Sunday morning you have to fight it and come here. So it is a proof that it exists. Sattva, tamas. Principle of inertia. Lots of places in this world you will find. So stones just exist, tamasic. There are animals which are tamasic. Example. Hippopotamus, buffalo, python, they'll just be there. Plants which are tamasic? Cactus. Which are tamasic plants? No idea. moss. You find out and come next to it. Which are the tamasic plants? Rajasic? Very difficult. That's why we should know.
We can't Google it.
But why are you saying you can't Google it? You may be able to get it because there are lots of Indian stuff up there in Google. Tamasic plant. If Google does not have results for tamasic plant, Google itself is an example of tamas. I don't know. That's the quality of tamas. Google says, I don't know. So anyway, the point is that you will see the effects everywhere. The principle of inertia. In our own mind, body, there's a lot of tamas which exists. There's a Subhashita which says, Alasyam hi manushyanam sharirastho maharipuhu. That laziness is one of the greatest enemies of a human being, and it resides in the body. Meaning body makes us feel lazy. So tamasic, principle of inertia we see everywhere. Principle of dynamism and activity also we see. There's so much of rajoguna, activity, ambition, achievement, movement, so much of movement in the whole world in Prakriti. Again, rajasic animals, rajasic plants, rajasic people, lots of them. Tiger, lion, very rajasic. Cheetah, leopard, deer, most of the animals will classify in that category. Most of the humans also come under that category, rajasic. Rajasic plants also are there. Pitcher plant. Touch me not.
The banyan tree.
So lots of them, rajasic ones. And then the sattvic is the principle of knowledge and balance. So we see the principle of knowledge and balance also in the world. There is a certain harmony, there is a certain rhythm in which the whole universe operates. There is a lot of rational and knowledge behind it. So using these three, see we do not perceive the gunas directly, we see the effect of these three gunas, like principle of inertia, dynamism and activity and knowledge. Maya is that which has all these three inherent in itself. So that is the power of Maya. And because of these three powers, what happens? Maya has these two capacities. One is called as veiling power, what we call as avarana in Vedant, and other is called as projecting power, which is called as vikshepa. So on one hand Maya veils the truth, and on the other hand it projects it as something else. So in small things of life you will see that. Where we don't know, then we project. Somebody's phone is ringing. The example of Maya this is. They don't know, only their own phone is ringing. And they think it's somebody else's phone it is. So anyway, the point is, I don't know, so I project. So in daily life we will see that. We don't know about that person at all, but just looking at that person, one starts projecting. I think this must be a South Indian fellow. But from the face I think he looks like a Marwadi. But then when he starts talking, Lagta Sindhi hai. Some goes on. Projection. Age, my God, how much people project. I think that person must be at least 40 years. And anyway, you are not supposed to ask the age. So all the more projection. And looking at the appearance, one will project. So when I don't know, then I project. That's a simple principle, always. In the darkness, I don't know what is there, I project. There is a cockroach, there is a ghost, there is snake, something is there. Mind projects. So this power of veiling and power of projecting, these are the powers of Maya. How does it veil? So Maya on one hand veils the truth from us. So I don't know who I am. I don't know the reality behind this world. And it projects. So I think of myself as this body and I see this world of objects as real. I don't know what is behind this. I don't know what is my own nature. So many people say that in spirituality we are trying to know the unknown. It is a journey from the known to the unknown. It is not a journey from known to the unknown. It is a journey from the projection of the known to the reality behind the known. That's all. It is not a journey from known to unknown, that we don't know what is it and so we are searching some unknown factor. There is a factor is known, it is a truth. What one is searching is the truth. What is the reality behind me, the individuality? There is a reality, obviously. Today I don't know it, so I am calling it as unknown. But can I say that I don't know it? No, I know it, but I don't experience it right now. I don't feel it right now. I'm not aware of it right now because our attention is outside, that's all. So the whole journey is not to seek some unknown concept. If that becomes clear to me, I'm not going to seek truth somewhere out there, up there, different from me. I am trying to know the essence of my own personality. Because today I am trapped in the projection of what is known. The reality which is there, that I don't know. That's what it says, Brahma Padam Tvam Pravisha Viditva. That Brahman is your nature. That is your true identity. Know that. Maya Mayamidam Akhilam Budva. Know that all this is just a projection. So in any situation, if I am able to see a thing as it is, that is called being away from Maya. We don't have to do something extraordinary, go away, leave the house. Because many people think that this world is Maya. So if I have to deal with money, people, power, position, all these, then that is called Maya. So, Swamiji, aap to itne dhanya ho gaye, ye sab aap Maya jal se mukt ho gaye. People think, that's their own projection, Maya jal se mukt ho gaye. Because they think that Maya is this. One Swamiji went to a house. That Swamiji was very young, some 21 years old, he renounced the world. So he went to somebody's house, bhiksha, and these people started. Hum to ye samsar ke chakke mein pis rahe hain Swamiji, aap to dhanya ho gaye, maya jal se aap mukt ho gaye, ye ho gaya, wo ho gaya. He started praising. Aap itne mahan hain, he said, dekhiye, main aap sabko pranam karta hoon, kyunki main महान नहीं हूँ, आप बहुत महान हैं। से नहीं नहीं स्वामी जी, हम कहाँ महान हुए, आप इतने महान हैं, इतने छोटी उम्र में आपने सब कुछ त्याग कर दिया। से नहीं नहीं भाई, मैं आपको प्रणाम करता हूँ, आप मुझसे भी महान हैं। एंड दैट पर्सन ऑल्सो द ऑडेसिटी टू आस्क, आप बताइए हम कैसे महान हो गए। तो दैट स्वामी जी सेड, देखो मैंने तो नश्वर का त्याग किया शाश्वत के लिए, आपने शाश्वत का त्याग कर दिया नश्वर के लिए, तो कौन महान हुआ? आई हैव ड्रॉप द फाइनाइट फॉर द इन्फिनिट, यू हैव ड्रॉप द इन्फिनिट फॉर द फाइनाइट, सो हु इज ग्रेटर? थिंक अबाउट इट। सो लॉट ऑफ पीपल थिंक लाइक दैट, दैट यू नो माया मीन्स ऑल दिस वर्ल्ड एंड ऑल दैट एंड पावर पोजिशन, इसको तो पुत्र की माया है, धन की माया है। It's a very colloquial usage, which is okay. But in our Vedantic understanding, Maya means not to see a thing as it is and to see it as something else, to project it at something else. So this power of veiling, avarana, is because of the tamas. And vikshepa is because of the rajas. And hence for a Vedantic student, what is important is the power of inquiry or knowledge, which is jnana. This jnana is the power of sattva-guna. So in Maya, because these three powers are there, rajas, tamas, tamas, rajas and sattva, the more we live in tamas and rajas, the more we will be living in projections, not with the reality. But the more we increase sattva guna in our mind, the mind will be more objective, the person will be able to inquire into who am I, inquire beyond the appearances of the world, beyond the names and forms which are there in the world. Otherwise, names and forms entice away. All that which we learnt earlier is the sattvic aspect. So when we see an object which is pleasurable, Raja Govindam tells us, don't look at it as pleasurable. Etan mamsa vasadi vikaram. It is only a modification of flesh and bones. Don't look at it as pleasurable. Don't look at money as the cause of happiness. Mudha jahihi dhanagama trishna. So appearances deceive us because we live in tamas and rajas. We get carried away by our own projections. If you actually inquire into what is this truth of this, the truth will be very different. I have given you many examples of that. Even a simple example of the food item. So if I say that, let us say, some black forest pastry looks very attractive. And, what, even if one has diabetes, even if one has so many other problems of the health, but looking at that black forest pastry, at that time, if the shloka comes, no, maya mayam idam akhilam buddhva, then you are a Vedantic student. Shloka should not merely come to your head and say that anyway it is maya, chalo eat, my eating also is a maya. That shloka should remind you ki what is the reality. This black forest is only an appearance. It is really a forest in which I can get lost. I'm telling you. Milk, sugar. So that is what. So if I want temporary pleasure, okay, let me compromise it. That's why we say pranam hai aap sabko. No problem. But if you want Brahman, then black forest, maya, mayam idam akhilam buddhva.
But Swamiji, you are saying that eating is not a problem, desiring more and more is a problem. So one piece.
Eating also is a problem because you see that black forest, what it does to your body. You ask the body what it does to the body. Our mind and our tongue feels, wow, maja, maja, maja. Body says, saja, 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 over. Because the amount of sugar that is there, you ask her, she is a doctor, no? She will tell you. You can eat a black forest, go to her lab, get tested. She will tell you what is the fluctuation in the hormones, what happens to you, sugar level, what happens to the body, how much of reaction. Body goes into what you call trauma only, actually that's the word. It goes through trauma. For the amount of sugar influx that comes straight away and the hormone shoots up, finished. But we don't know, maya maya midam akhilam buddhva. We are so living happily, eating black forest in the night and sleep. Bhagwan is sitting inside, na? He has to do aham vaishvanaro bhutva. He is sitting in the belly and he has to say, are mujhe itna kyun tadpa rahe ho? He has to take care of the whole body, and in spite of all the abuses that we do to the body, how much the body manages to adapt and put up itself. The moment a disease happens is only because the body has gone beyond its capacity to adapt. You see this bridge and all, when they build, now what they do? They have to have a load-bearing capacity, that this much of weight this bridge can bear. So they will put that foundation and all that stuff, and then that much of load bearing it has to do. Suppose a bridge collapses, what does that mean? It means that either it was not built properly or the bearing capacity was exceeded. Till then it will keep adapting. Till then it keep resisting. Same thing happens to the body. So we don't realize what happens to us. Even mentally, forget at the body level. Mentally what we go through. Simple example, if I tell a lie, what happens to me? I am not even aware. It is so taken for granted today that you can tell a lie. It is a common thing. How does it matter? Nothing happens. No, everybody is doing it. But doctors today are realizing that every stressful thought has an impact on the body. Every negative emotion creates a hormonal imbalance, secretes some harmful hormones. All that keeps happening. But we don't realize that. Because the mind is stuck in its own desire, in its own projection, that it's okay, that benefit that it will give me is more valuable to me. So the mind goes carried away. So if a Vedantic seeker, when we say Maya Mayavidam Akhilam Buddhva, there is another version of this which says Maya Mayavidam Akhilam Hitva. Hitva means drop. They drop all this knowing that this is Maya, meaning what is not being seen by us as it is being seen by us as a projection, as we are being told it is. So many times we have given that example, no? Somebody who drinks for the first time, how does that person feel actually? First time anybody tries alcohol, it will be bitter only, no? And one will spit it out, one can't handle it. But the projection is drinking is equal to pleasure. Drinking is equal to status. Now what all goes on in the world in the name of that? I don't think anything else we indulge in which is so tamasic as a drink. And the older the drink, the greater the price. 200 years old, useless. 3 ghante ke andar wo khana tamasik ho jata hai, we are saying. Now preserve this. Breweries, 200 year old. This is a precious bottle, 200 year old bottle. Piyo usko. How tamasik that is. One nice kick one gets. But that's the way it is, because it is projected, it is shown like that. One gets carried away by that. So Maya Mayamidam Akhilam Buddhva, Maya Mayamidam Akhilam Hitva. That knowledge that this is Maya should help me to drop the false projections. These are all, lots of them are false projections. And the moment I start dropping the false projection, my mind becomes sattvic and ready enough to inquire into what is the truth. So if I actually go into the truth of the matter, quite a lot of things are just assumptions. Because what we see is not how it is. And that's why the definition of Maya is this. We say that Maya means, you just reverse the word, Yama. Yama means that which is not. This is a literal meaning. That which is actually not there, but it appears to be there. That is called Maya. So for a Vedantic seeker, it is important to live in Sattva Guna, so that the mind has the capacity to inquire into what is this truth, what is this Brahman. Otherwise, Rajas and Tamas are occupying us. Inertia and projection, inertia and projection. Even in relationships, that is what happens to us. No? And we are not able to see the person as the person is. Our own projection it is. That person would have changed also long back, but I am still dealing with the image of the person with the projection in my own mind. That is the Maya Jal actually. The Maya Jal is not outside. The Maya Jal is the cobwebs in the mind which we have created, which are there for such a long time. And now I am perceiving the world through all those cobwebs only. I am not seeing it for the reality that it is actually. (Clears throat) So a seeker who starts seeing this reality will start living according to that. Those things which we gave, na, the 10 areas in life where we should increase sattva guna. So according to that, when we start living in a sattvic way, you see the difference that happens. How much the mind is available for inquiry, how much the mind is peaceful, balanced, how deep it goes into introspection, in meditation, wandering of the mind will stop. Anger, desire, greed, jealousy, all these will not have that much impact on the mind. Why? Because one has known the assumptions and dropped them. Otherwise, the assumptions only create all these negativities. In our family packed module, we have these four words. Perception leads to assumptions. Assumptions lead to confusion, and the confusion leads to tension. This is the way it works. So my perception, when it is colored by rajas and tamas, it will lead into assumption that this has happiness, that has pleasure, this is painful, all assumptions. And how sad it is, you know, you think about it, that in spirituality we are actually here to drop all the assumptions, but to come to spirituality itself I have so many assumptions. When I come to spirituality, pata nahi kya hoga. Lots of people still think in today's world also that ashram means there will be cows, there will be goats, there will be a thatched roof, there will be hut, because that is the depiction of the ashram in all the mythological serials. So first time when some of the youngsters come to our ashram, they are wonderstruck. Building hai idhar? Ar kya building hai idhar? What are you talking? We don't live in thatched roofs without electricity, with a cow nearby and one goat there, sitting below some tree. But that is the assumption. And people have all kinds of weird assumptions. And they will tell us to run away from the house, they will tell us to do this, they will tell us don't bother about your career, yahan pe aake seva karna chalu kar do, seva mahi aapka kalyan hai. What all people think? All assumptions. So about everything there are assumptions. That is actually called as maya. So he says, maya mayamidam akhilam buddhva. So this power of maya is what veils the truth, projects something else. So as far as the individual is concerned, the truth which is my nature as Sachidananda, which we call as Atma. Atma means I, the self. And the nature of this Atma is Sat, Chit, Anand. Now this Atma is veiled by these layers and layers of ignorance and assumptions. And then something else is projected. So then I don't know who I am, that my nature is Sachidananda, and then I think of myself to be this body, mind, intellect and a bundle of vasanas. So this is a projection. So the truth of my own nature, which is Atma, is not known. And something else which I am not, which is only an equipment. I have a body to perceive the world. I have a mind to feel the emotions. I have an intellect to think. These are equipment that I have. But I think I am that equipment because I don't know who I am. So for the individual, that is what is being done. The Maya in the individual, when it functions, for the individual it is called as avidya. In the each individual, Maya, when it operates, the same power of Maya which veils the truth, projects the untruth, that same power of Maya is called as avidya. So avidya in her, in me, in her, in him, in all these. So in individual it is called as avidya, and collectively when it is put together it is called as Maya. So if you understand the power of Maya veils and projects, then same thing happens in the individual life. It veils the truth and projects something else. So as far as the individual is concerned, I don't know the reality of my nature and I think of this BMI as real. And as far as the world is concerned, I think that the world as we see is real. So I don't know what is that which is behind this world. So that substratum of the world, which is what we call as Brahman, which is also of the nature of Satchidananda, that substratum of the world we don't experience. What we see is only name and form. It's like saying that I don't see the water, but I see only the form of the wave and the name. So this is a big wave, this is a small wave, is the name. And then the form. But I miss out on the essence, which is water. So same thing one does with respect to the world. I don't know the reality behind the world. So I see whatever I see, that is real for me. And as far as me, the individual, is concerned, I don't know who I am and what I know myself as, this personality, that becomes real. So when we say that know the truth, viditva, brahma padam tvam pravisha viditva, what do I have to know? I have to know this Satchidananda, that my nature is Sat Chit Ananda. And when I realize that my nature is Satchidananda, my meaning, not the personality, body, mind, intellect. That is an equipment that I have. I am truly of the nature of Satchidananda, and that is the nature of each and every one. That is called as moksha, that is called as realization or sakshatkar, because I have come to know that my nature is Satchidananda. And what is that nature? Satchidananda is infinite. Then that person has woken up. No more that person thinks that I am this individuality, no more the person thinks that this world is real. So this is what Vedanta is trying to tell us. And that God which we are talking about, that very Ishvara has created this whole world, and we are the Jivas right now. How do I get out of this Maya now? Three ways. Number one, it was said here, knowledge. Brahma padam tvam pravisha viditva. In any situation, our attempt must be to see the truth as it is, not as a projection. So I can ask a simple question to myself, that is it the truth or is it my projection? So much assumptions we make. How much? We send an SMS to somebody, that person doesn't reply. What happens? One can wait. Maybe the person is busy. Maybe the person has not read it. Maybe the battery has died. 100 things can happen. But no. Wantedly he is ignoring me. Earlier though he would wait for my SMS. If I don't SMS, he would ask me 10 times, what happened? Now, even if I send SMS, nothing happens. I am on WhatsApp also. From all possible sources, SMS, WhatsApp, Viber, Facebook, from everywhere I am attacking, but nothing is happening. Assume. Simply, no? So in any situation, what is the truth? I should know that. And in this, what will help is, I should stop taking things personally. Yes. Simple and very practical tip is, stop taking things personally. Even if it is intended at us, if I don't take it personally, I don't suffer. So that I will be in a state of mind which is positive and sattvic, then I can deal with it. But if I start taking it personally, I am becoming rajasic and tamasic. I get agitated by myself. Why should I take it personally? For what? So many times it is not even intended at us, but still we take it personally. We give an opinion in the meeting and it is not taken. It's just an opinion. It was not taken because it was considered at its merit and it was dismissed, over. But my opinion was rejected. I sat in the meeting. So much time I spent and I gave the opinion and my opinion was rejected. gone. That is called taking it personally. Many times, you know, parent-child conflict is not on the issue, it is on the ego. That I am the parent and I am telling my child to follow and my child is not listening to me. That means my child is disobedient. Issue is something else only. Now the fight is happening on what? Child is not obedient. And how can my child be disobedient? What the people in the world will think? That how have I brought up my child? Gone. That issue is something else, but I have taken it personally. Everywhere you will find that it becomes very personal. So one of the ways to do it is to, when we say that, try to know. So don't take it personally. The moment I stop taking it personally, I am objective enough to deal with the situation. Second, Bhagavan says that this Maya is very, very difficult to cross. And the only way to cross this Maya is surrender to Ishvara. And that is where the concept of that personal God comes. That there, when we surrender, in the 9th chapter in the Gita, Bhagavan says that. 9th or 7th, I forgot, one of the chapters it is. But he says that, Daivi yesha gunamai mama maya duratyaya. That my maya is divine and it is very difficult to cross this maya. How to cross it then? Mameva ye prapadyante maya metam tarantite. Those who surrender unto me, they will cross. Meaning, one who surrenders the individuality in the state of devotion. And for that is where we require the personification. Because surrender to Brahman, which is infinity, can we surrender to infinity? Because we think of infinity as a concept only. And infinity is considered as some energy, some power. We can't surrender to that because the bhavana doesn't come. But with the same infinite truth, when it is depicted as Krishna or Rama or Durga or Devi, whatever it is, then we are surrendering. Now don't think that we are surrendering to some imaginary concept. No, we are surrendering to the creator of this world, which is Ishvara. And Ishvara has power. Ishvara has Ichha Shakti, Kriya Shakti, Jnana Shakti, all the things that Ishvara has. Unlimited power, unlimited compassion, unlimited knowledge, unlimited love is the nature of that Ishvara. It is infinity. So if I am surrendering, I am not surrendering to some unknown entity which I don't know whether it exists, does not exist. If I understand this concept that which is infinite cause of the universe is manifesting as Ishvara, as the creator. And to that Ishvara when I surrender, as long as I feel I am the Jiva, the individual, there is an Ishvara. As long as I think that I am the effect, there has to be a cause. If I don't see myself as an effect, then there is no problem. But I still see myself as an effect. No, I was born into this world. Somebody gave me birth. This world was created by somebody. So I am still an effect. People around me are an effect. The world is an effect. So there has to be a cause. That cause cannot be Brahman. But that cause is Ishvara. And that Ishvara, when I surrender, where is that Ishvara? In my own heart. So I am not surrendering to an Ishvara out there. In the Gita it is said, Ishvara sarva bhutanam hriddeshe arjuna tishthati. Bhagavan says that, oh Arjun, understand that Ishvara is in the hearts of every creature. Ishvara sarva bhutanam hriddeshe arjuna tishthati brahmayan sarva bhutani. And that Ishvara only is deluding everybody as though by the power of his maya. So if you seek that Ishvara in your heart, that the Lord is in me, as what? As the very enlivening principle, because of which I am alive, because of which the body, mind, intellect can function. It is in my own heart. Today it is covered, that truth or that Ishvara is covered. That's the whole concept of the aarti. When we do the aarti in the South Indian temples, if you go, you cannot see the Lord. Nowadays, some of them have put a bulb or a tube light inside, but otherwise, traditional temple, if you go, The sanctum sanctorum is totally dark. So if you have to have the vision of the Lord, what you have to do? You have to tell the pujari, please do the aarti. So pujari will say, in whose name? So he will ask you the name and the gotra and all that. Then the camphor will be lit and the name and the gotra etc. will be chanted. And when the pujari is doing the aarti, in that we see the Lord. So that camphor is the symbol of our own individuality, the ego. And that ego is burning. And camphor is such a thing that it burns, leaving nothing. It totally disappears, evaporates. I mean burns away fully. Maximum the plate will be black, nothing else will remain. So the idea is that when I surrender myself completely, in that total surrender, I have the vision of the Lord. Right now the sanctum sanctorum, actually if you see the temple architecture is very beautiful. Temple architecture is like a sleeping man. Do you know that? The sanctum sanctorum is the heart of the individual. The gates are the feet. Then there is a dhvaja stambha, that is the solar plexus. Then there is a sanctum sanctorum. So it goes like that. In Vastu Shastra, if you see, it's like a sleeping man. Maybe next time I will bring a very beautiful symbolism of a temple. So, and also that actually means that as you go through the gates, go to the dvaja stambha, go to the tortoise, each one you go and then finally you come to the sanctum sanctorum. It is also the movement in the chakras, from the lower chakra to upper, 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 finally one comes to the last one. Very beautiful. So the whole depiction is that the Lord is in my own heart and that Lord is covered by ignorance, darkness, with desire. So when I surrender to the Lord, that Lord is not only the Ishvara totality, but that same Lord is in my own heart. Like that water is there in every wave. So I am not surrendering to a hallucinated concept. I am surrendering to the truth which is there outside, which is there inside. But it can be realized only in my heart. Hence using the form, I surrender to that truth. What is the expression of that surrender? Expression of that surrender is acceptance. That let thy will be done, not mine. You are the doer, I am only an instrument. That acceptance, when it comes, the person has surrendered. This helps a person to live in sattva guna. Heat, cold, pleasure, pain, praise, insult, success, failure, whatever comes, one will hold on to Ishvara, saying, ki Bhagavan, this is your prasad. So that Ishvara buddhi is there all the time. That this has come by your grace, I accept it. Come by your grace, I accept it. Whatever actions I do, I dedicate unto you. So all the time in the mind, there is Ishvara arpana buddhi. So that mind will get out of its preoccupation with ego. That is called surrender. And when a person becomes like that, accepting, comes in a sattvic level, and that bhavana of surrender is there, person realizes that I and that Ishvara are actually one in our true nature. So either through knowledge and contemplation in meditation you realize it, or through surrender, where one surrenders to Ishvara and lives moment by moment in acceptance of life. These are the two main ways actually. The third one, which is karma yoga, is only expression of the other two. That I dedicate all the actions to the Lord, I dedicate the doership to the Lord, I accept the results as prasad. These three ways help a person to surrender, go beyond maya. And when a person goes beyond maya, meaning experiences that which is changeless, that person goes beyond Ishvara also, remember that. Goes from individual to total to beyond. So our whole journey is from Jiva to surrender to Ishvara, and when I completely surrender to Ishvara, I realize Brahman beyond Maya. I will end with two aspects. This is the significance of 108. One of the significances is this. 8 represents the world, duality. 0 represents Maya. 1 represents Brahman. My journey has to be from duality to Brahman, going beyond Maya. That is my journey. 0 is Maya. 1 is Brahman, absolute truth. To remind you all the time that you have to go beyond duality, the truth is in your own heart, just realize that non-dual truth. Go beyond this Maya. 8 is this world. The world is constituted of 8 things. 5 elements, the Jiva, the sun and the moon. 8. Ashtadha Prakriti it is called. Why sun and the moon? Sun and the moon are the illumining principle. Jiva is the individual going through this world, and the 5 elements, space, air, fire, water, earth, the material cause of the universe. So these 8 things constitute the world. And so when I do japa, it is to invoke that surrender so that I go from duality to non-duality. And to do that, I need the grace of the Lord. This Jiva Bhava will go when I surrender to Ishvara, that there is a totality, I surrender. Because who am I? One small, tiny, little individual as a Jiva. What is my existence? You just think about it, the number of Jivas which exist, countless. One little Jiva I am actually. From Jiva standpoint, there is no difference between me and a small little ant. No difference. The difference is only in the equipment. But okay, I have a human body, it has the body of an ant. Jiva is the same. So I am actually nothing compared to the infinite. And the number of Jivas which are there, I am just one of the Jivas. So as long as I feel I am the Jiva, I have to surrender to an Ishvara, there is no other choice. Either surrender to Ishvara, or in Vedanta we say surrender to Guru. But that Guru also is considered Ishvara only, no? Guru Sakshat Parabrahma. So we are actually surrendering to whom? Surrendering to Ishvara only. This is one aspect. And the last one is that just now this Onam festival went, right? So in that Onam, the festival is celebrated because of this fact that Bali Raja, you know Bali? He was a king of demons. He was the grandson of Prahlad. And he won over all the 3 worlds, became very, very powerful. And as usual, devatas are helpless fellows. They do only 2 things. Stand in the clouds and start putting flowers whenever some good things happen and Bhagwan come. Or fight with the asuras, get vanquished and go begging Bhagwan, Are, please help, please help, please help. So they went to Vishnu Bhagwan saying, ki, Abhi, please help us, and you know this Bali Raja has become so powerful and he wants to become Indra also. So he is doing one yajna, Ashwamegha yajna or something he is doing there. So Bhagwan goes there as a Vaman, as a dwarf. And one thing Bali Raja is known for is that he gives charity. Nobody will turn back from his altar empty-handed. So Vaman avatar, so Bhagwan goes there. And when he goes there, he asks him that I have come here. And especially when one is doing a yajna and a havan, etc., the end of it one has to do dan. So it is a very important part of the ritual. So that day's event, when it is over, this Bali Raja, when he is finishing that, Vaman Avatar Bhagwan goes there and he asks him for some dan. He says, whatever you want, you ask me. He said, I want only land occupied by 3 footsteps. Shukracharya, who is the teacher of this Bali Raja, he says, ki, don't commit, because this is Vishnu who has come in another form and he will deceive you. Don't commit. Bali Raja said, I am committed to the word I give. that I will give, nobody will return empty handed. So he takes the kamandalu. So Shukracharya goes there and blocks the outlet so that the water should not come out, because water is the way in which they would give earlier. So if something is decided, okay, now I give you, then they will take water and they will pour it. That means that is over, now it belongs to you. No legal agreement and contract and all that. Pani liya, de diya, gone. That is yours, huh? So Shukracharya blocked that. This Bali Raja took pieces of straw and he thought something is blocking it, so he poked it. So Shukracharya lost his eye. He came out and he got very angry. He said, you are not following the words of the Guru, you will suffer. So it doesn't matter, I am committed to give. My Guru only taught me that I should keep up my word, so that much I am following. So he gave, Tathastu, he gave. Bhagavan, you take. So with one foot Bhagavan covers the whole manifest world. With other foot he covers the space. Now he says, where do I put my third foot? So this Bali Raja says that, okay, then if you have to use the third foot, then please place it on my head. So he bends and Bhagavan puts it, his foot on, because he grows in size, and then he puts the foot on his head and Bali Raja goes into the nether worlds, Patal. Sutal, not Patal, he goes to Sutalalok. So that is the story of Bali Raja, that Vaman Avatar took and he was pushed there. But Bali Raja had three desires. One is he wanted to become Indra. So Bhagavan said, for the next Manvantara you will become the Indra. Second, he said, I must visit my own people. So it is said, on the day of Onam, this Bali Raja comes and visits all the houses in Kerala. I don't know why he visits only Kerala. Because he conquered the whole world. Whatever, yeah. God's own country, so maybe he is ruling God's own country, so he goes there. There's one more desire that he had. I forgot what he had. Three desires that he had. One was to become Indra, one was to visit his people. And third, he is made the king of the Sutala Loka. So he rules there. So these seven worlds which are there, which are below, meaning they are called seven levels of hell. Atala, Vitala, Sutala, Rasatala, Talatala, Mahatala and Patala. Seven worlds which are hell. So he lives in Sutal world, which is supposed to be full of, you know, each level is supposed to be one greater and greater level of suffering. But even there he rules and he is happy. Why? Because the symbolism is very beautiful. When he bends to the Lord, that is a symbol of the Jiva surrendering, that I give up myself. When Jiva gives up Jiva Bhav, Ishwar also gives up Ishwar Bhav. So Bali Raja actually became a realized man, that he realized Brahman. So his Jiva Bhav gone, he went beyond Ishwar also, realized Brahman. So that day is the day of Onam and they celebrate that day. Because traditionally actually it means that Bali Raja became realized, because that is a symbol of surrender, and he is the grandson of Prahlad. So Prahlad actually comes there and he prays to the Lord and he says that, oh Lord, you are so great that you have blessed my own grandson, that under your feet he has come now straight away. So for the story part it looks as though Bhagavan crushed him below his feet, but symbolically he gave up the Jiva Bhav. Ishwara also gave up Ishwar Bhav, realized Brahman. So that way, as long as I am a Jiva, I will have to surrender to an Ishwara. And the surrender to Ishwara in my own heart will make me realize that I am that non-dual Brahman. So for today we will stop here. Next class, when do we have? Next Sunday. Yeah, next Sunday we'll have. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate
पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेव वशिष्यते। ओम शांति शांति शांति। हरि ओम। श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः। हरि ओम।